I'm Melanie Johnson, along with my co-host Jen Foster. We are both 13-time best-selling authors. We've published over 2,500 books and made all of our authors number one bestsellers. We own Elite Online Publishing. If you want to become a best-selling author, look us up at EliteOnlinePublishing.com. Now, welcome to the podcast that shares secrets from top industry experts that show you how to get lasting success and results. This is the Elite Expert Insider Podcast.
Hello, everyone. We have an exciting time today because we are launching and releasing a book by Mitra Bradford. And so I'm going to bring Melanie Johnson on for a minute, and we're going to talk a little bit about the book publishing process. And then we're going to be inviting Mitra Bradford on to talk about her book and her experience in writing and publishing, as well as the contents of her book and how you can attract your life and discover your greatness. Let's talk a little bit about our book launch process, Melanie, and how we release books out into the world of Amazon.
Sure. So it's, you know, people, you can do it yourself. People think, oh, maybe I can do that myself. But then when they realize the process and everything we do, it's so different. And all the software we have, all the technology that we have behind us, and all the expertise we have behind us of doing what we've done, like 2,600 books that we've launched. So I tell people, you know, they think, oh, well, is it easy to get number one? Well, it is if you know what you're doing on the back end. And like we had an author the other day, he had used an unknown publishing company and he got it in one category and he was so excited. Well, I made one category, and but he didn't hit international. And usually all of our authors virtually hit usually 8 to 13 categories, not counting all the other countries they get number one in. And why do you want to do that? Well, it's like, you know, being a football hero in your hometown versus being an NFL superstar, right? That's kind of the difference. So more people know you. It's a much bigger audience, a much bigger platform for you to be identified with. So that's why it's important to have a team behind you and the right team behind you when you're doing this. And as Mai just said, she says, I didn't think it was going to be this much fun. I'm having so much fun doing it. And that's what it really should be when you're launching your book. You've put so much work into it. It and you don't want it to be stressful. We want it to be a great experience and an exciting experience that you get to kind of go along for the ride and collaborate with us to make your dream come true of your book. And the important thing about your book is that to remember, don't get caught up in all the royalties. It's really the other side of what the book does for you. You know, one thing I tell people is, oh my gosh, you're going to have enough content for years to come just for social media alone. You're going to have each chapter can be a speech that you can give or a talk you can give or an interview you can give on a podcast or on TV. And really the process of writing your book is so cathartic. We've worked with a variety of authors to create their book from start to finish, and they feel like they've gone through 5 years of therapy by the time they've written their book, and all of a sudden they have this immediate clarity on their business, their life, their focus of what they should be doing, because all of a sudden they've taken all that stuff rattling around in their head and now they've got it all down on paper and they have clarity and they have an abundance of aha moments. And I know Mitra has had that as well. So part of our process is that when we launch a book, we launch it for 24 hours at 99 cents for the ebook to propel as many sales as possible during that time and generate excitement during that time.
Yes, and we have Mitra here who's going to be telling us a little bit about her writing process, how she came up with the idea for this book, and then we'll get into the contents of the book. So let's welcome Mitra Bradford.
Hi.
Hey, Mitra, how are you?
Good. How are you?
Doing great.
Hey, Mitra.
Hi.
So today's your big, exciting day. How are you feeling?
I am so excited. I've been waiting for this moment for a long time. It's a little bit, it feels so real. Like, I'm like, wow. Like, I woke up this morning and was like, wow, today's the day, right?
Yeah. So, you know, you talk about manifestation and attracting this. So, did you attract and manifest writing your book?
Well, yeah, I was attracting a lot of things in my life and was like, how's this happening or how'd this occur, right? And I would take like classes and, you know, try to use law of attraction, but it wasn't working for me. And a lot of other people that I know, they were saying it wasn't working. Mm-hmm. Not until I like stepped back and kind of realize who I was, that then I realized how law of attraction could work for me. So it was a long time coming. I started this in 2016. So I start in the book about my favorite poem, which is What Happens to a Dream Deferred by Langston Hughes. And that's how I felt, like it festered inside of me, right? So the purpose of this book was for me to help people not to get stuck in manifesting their dreams. So yeah.
You know, one of the things that you mentioned right off was, I didn't know myself. That's why it wasn't working for me. So how do we get to know ourselves?
Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of things that was usually told, like you talk too much when you're in school, right?
Yeah.
That's probably a sign about something that you're supposed to be doing, your purpose, or, you know, you're always getting in trouble. Whatever is usually that thing that that person was usually getting in trouble for is usually kind of tied into what that person's purpose is. Mm-hmm. It's something that is maybe not refined when you're young, mm-hmm. right? But as you get older, it's either pushed away because it just doesn't fit in, or you're kind of ashamed of it, yeah. or yeah. you kind of explore it. So it's that process of kind of re-remembering why you came here, right? And what was your yeah. reasoning to be here, you know? So...
That's so funny. I mean, I remember I was just telling the story the other day. We drove by my school when I was in kindergarten. I said, you know, I remember getting sent out into the hall when I was in kindergarten for talking too much in class. What a surprise. Yeah.
Of course. Right,
so right there. You just hit the nail on the head.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And for me, I would get in trouble all the time for questioning the teacher. Like, why are we doing this? Yeah. What's going on? So like this whole book, it's all about process, right? So I'm right. always about process and understanding why it's supposed to be. So yeah. that's where this book came from. So,
and a lot of it you talk about is like reprogramming your thoughts. Mm-hmm. And I find it so hard to break habits that we've had, especially the older that we get, you know, whether it's, you know, you brush your teeth a certain way, or, you know, the way you get into bed. I mean, just little regular things that you do all the time. How do you go about reprogramming your thoughts, for Pete's sakes? I mean, that just seems like that would be really hard to do.
Yeah. So it's really like reframing it. It's really about not putting it bad or good, but just yeah. understanding why you did it that way in the first reset. Mm-hmm. So once you understand why you did it that way at first, then if you want to change or tweak it, it'll be easier. So let's take the example that you were just talking about, talking too much, right? When you were a kid, right? So it's about reframing it like, I just have a lot to say and I want to share with everyone, right? See how that changes for like a parent who's yeah. talking to a child, you know, it's mm-hmm. not that you can't, you know, that you're being bad because you talk too much. No, it's, you have a lot to say. Okay. So let me try to find a platform for you. And this is how I deal with my kids. I'm like, so let me try to find a platform for you to express yourself in that way, you know, yeah. or, you know, a person who, you know, says they want to have a relationship, right? They find themselves always in the same type of relationship that is, toxic, right? So yeah. instead of, oh, something about wrong with me, which it could be, right? It could be, right? But it's about reframing it. Like, okay, so let's see, what is the key components of these people that I keep dating or I keep attracting in my life? What is that about, right? So who, yeah. What is the framework with that, right? And then why do I find myself attracting to that? Am I going to the same type of bar that they're at, you know, or same yeah. type of club or same type of industry that they're, you know, these people who I don't want to date are in. So once you kind of like frame and understand why you're in the situation first, then you can reframe it and change it to where you want to be. Yeah. So it's not like, it's about taking something out, but putting yeah. something else in. Right. So.
And being conscious to do that all the time and not fall back into those yeah. regular habits. And you talk about the law of oneness, which we're going to get back to, because I find that whole concept interesting, the law of oneness and then going into the manifestation. But tell us, what inspired you to write your book?
You know, because I was stuck. I was stuck. And then instead of me blaming everyone else or, you know, blaming the situation, I wanted to, like I said, analyze what was the missing component, right? And then instead of me just holding it and hoarding it to myself, I started sharing yeah. with people. A lot of people were asking me, well, how are you doing it? Or, well, what's going on with you? You look different. Or, you know, you're so full of joy, you know, despite what could be occurring in my life, right? Or mm-hmm. in society, right? I still found joy about it, right? I still found myself connected to people in a way without stressing about the negative aspects of things, right?
Yeah.
So that's where the book came from. Like, I want to share with you my joy. I want to share with you how I think of things, right? And it's not just me. There's a lot of people who think this way, right? So can I share it with you? This is how I was. It was like almost like I was trying to write to my girlfriend, right? I was trying to write to my, you know, family members who are like, how do you do it, right? So this is how this book came about.
It was almost like you were buying Christmas presents for people. You know how you get excited when you find that right gift for someone, you can't wait to give it to them?
Yes, and I
think that's so true for so many authors. Once they start down the path, when they're working with the right team, like you did, it's like you've got this present that you're giving, not just to one person, but to the world. And you're just so excited to be able to give that to them. It's such a joy.
It is. And you know, it is just about sharing. So back to oneness. So when we talk about the law of oneness, when I look at you or when I look at someone who I don't know down the street, I can see my reflection in them. So it's like almost like I want to help you because I would want somebody to help me. Right. So it's not about me just, you know, pushing out something that I just think of. It's just like I feel like I'm seeing you in me, right? And I see me in you, and I just want to share. That's all. And when you walk through life in that type of concept of like, I just want to share, right? I just want to share with my friend. I want to share what I thought worked for me that may work for you. You have a different perspective, you know? You have a different perspective on things. So,
And tell us, some people don't know really what the law of oneness is. Define that for us.
It's one of the universal laws. And so like when we talk about the law of gravity, right? Whether you understand it fully or not, if you go jump out a window from a five-story high rise building, you're going to fall. You're going to find out what gravity means immediately.
Yeah, real quick.
So law of oneness is that we're all connected. We're all connected. We are part of God's source energy, whatever you would like to call the ultimate being. And we're all part of him, part of her. And in that, all of us are connected. So to the even the blade of grass that's outside, you know, to the tree, to the dog, to the cat, we're all connected. And so when you look at things or people throughout life and knowing that you're connected to them in some way, you have a certain type of love.
That's the same word I was thinking of before. I've read the book, but in my mind, it just takes you like, well, then you start to love everything when you know you're connected. And you don't want to hurt anyone. Just have that everywhere, right? How that would change everything.
When I was 16, my mother wrote to Mother Teresa in Calcutta. And one of the things that she said in the letter, which I still look at and read, she talks about finding the peace that you would like to have in someone else. So actually looking. So when you're talking to someone, to look at them in the eye and find peace for yourself and them. And I know this sounds weird, and you know, I kind of shared that I came from the financial background. You can have those loving moments sometimes, right?
Yeah.
But you can have a peaceful moment, you know, in the midst of a storm. You can still have peace. That's what the law of oneness kind of brings us to understand that we're all connected. But the main reason I wrote the book was because, like I said, I didn't think law of attraction worked. But everybody was talking about it. But like I said, I had to understand who I was. And so I found out who I was through understanding the law of oneness.
And so then what happens once you know who you are? How do you take the next step to make the law of attraction start to work with you? You know, you talk about the importance of abundance mentality and creativity and imagination. And so how do we, you know, we've taken the steps, we've been using things like from The Secret, it's not working, it doesn't seem like it's coming through. And now you've connected with yourself, you know who you are, then what happens?
You start to have a divinity and power and almost like confidence. That's what it really is. It's confidence that you start to have, like, you know what? Maybe I can do this, right? Maybe that dream that I had that I've been wanting to do, you know, to buy, a boat and go sailing. Maybe I can do that, right? You start thinking of things with possibilities. And as you think of things with possibilities, opportunities open up for you. So, and you celebrate it. So, and I talk about in the book, there's actually, it was a person who was a client, you know, and he had difficulty with money, but we learn how to celebrate everything. He's doing laundry and he finds an extra dollar in the laundry, you know, when he's pulling out the clothes. He celebrated that. He celebrated everything. So as you have these opportunities that are occurring, you're celebrating every small opportunity. So, and as you do that, you expand yourself to more opportunities. And then you'll see before you look, you're like, wow, I just increased my salary, right? But it's celebrating each of that because you're sending out a vibration of, oh, I appreciate this and I want more of it. So that's how it really works.
It's really that glass full mentality of looking at everything to be grateful for and what you're blessed for versus, you know, the challenges that you have to overcome. And what I find with you that you're so in touch with that and people that we work with that are, they tend to be action takers. They don't hesitate about their decisions because they know themselves and they know what they want and they just go for it versus like, well, I'm not sure. Like, I'm not sure if I should write my book. I'm not sure if now's the time to publish it. I'm not sure if I should move forward. What if, what if, what if? And like when you came to us, you're like, I'm writing this book. It's going to happen. I'm moving forward. Send me the contract. Bop, 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 done. You know? And that's the difference, I think, in life in general. And those people who, I mean, you want to make good decisions and make smart decisions and sometimes evaluate things. But when you're in that space, you're ready to go. You're ready to hit the ground running. And I think you're so in tune with, like you say, the universe and everybody else that's around you that it's easier to make those decisions. You don't have to vacillate back and forth. You know, you're right on that track. And that's how I can see, like, you've grown exponentially just in this last year because of that.
I have. But it also starts about, once again, knowing yourself and knowing that, you know what? If I make it, I don't call them mistakes. I call them experiences, right? And what did I learn from the experiences? So a person who makes quick decisions, sometimes somebody may say, oh, wow, she made a mistake. It's not a mistake. It was an experience. What do I learn from it, right? So every situation, whether you grade it as good or bad, is a learning experience, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's how you're able to make quicker decisions and feel confident because you're not looking at it in from a sense of, oh, I messed up. Oh, this or that. It's more of, I had another experience right here and this is what I learned from it. Okay, move on. Move on to the next. So it's a different way of thinking, right? It's a different way.
It totally is. And it kind of leads me into the question of the questions to ask. You say, you know, make sure you ask good quality questions. What are those questions we should be asking ourselves?
What do we want? That's the first question. Some people don't even know what they want.
Yeah.
And then when you realize, okay, how do I even figure out what do I want? Who am I, right? So before you can even like, who am I, right? What do I want to be known?
Yeah.
When I leave this earth, what do I want to be known for when I leave this earth? What type of influence do I want to have on people when I walk into a room? The way I want, when people walk into the room, they be like, oh, here she comes again. Or is it, oh, hey, you know, the energy, right? Well, if you bring that for yourself, you'll start understanding other questions to ask for yourself. So, you know, in the book, we have the workbook, the QR codes, the workbook. We have lots of exercises on meditating in a way to tap into what was your divine purpose. Why did you come here in the first place?
Yeah.
That's a good point. I was like, did I even shut mine off? That's the question we all ask, right? Like, why am I here? What am I supposed to be doing? Well, okay. How do I even define what I'm supposed to be doing, right?
Yeah.
Unless we just find a job. We just are working. We're not happy. Well, if you're not happy, that's the first thing. Why aren't you happy? That's the first question. Why aren't you happy? Can you define that? what does happiness mean for you? If you had a magic wand, you know, like we use this in counseling, if you had a magic wand, what would be the perfect life for you? Some people can't even answer that. So
those questions seem simple, but they're really hard.
They are.
You don't take the time to answer. You're like, well, I'm not really sure what makes me happy. And then when you get that, those things, are they really making you happy? You know, some people think, well, it's money if I had all the money. And then all of a sudden they're looking at other little micro things in their life that's making them unhappy because they tend to always do that. But, you know, those questions of, you had a lot of really great questions that you just came out. So I hope everyone writes those down, actually get the book because they're all in the book.
Yes. And then connecting yourself with the right people. Mm. Like, for example, I met you through my coach. We weren't supposed to be walking through our lives by ourselves. There's nothing that I think that anybody can accomplish without partnering with somebody. Mm-hmm. If you want greatness, you need to partner with someone who is greater than you, right? So you can achieve the goal. I don't know anything about publishing a book, you know, and kudos for people who are able to figure out and navigate on their own. But I want to partner with a company who this is their forte, right? Who can walk and lead me through that. So partnership is good too. And that's
very important. So when you talked with us, what was the key thing that you said, yes, I'm definitely hiring a lead online publishing?
To be honest, it was my coach. It was, you know, once you have that mentorship, because mentorship is very important. So even like I need to talk spiritually for a minute because I think that's like my main component of discovering who I was. Yeah. And all throughout different Bibles, there's a mentorship that happens between a teacher and a student, right? Yep. And you really have to have like that type of faith in your mentor. And I have that faith in my mentor. And like my clients, they have that faith in me. So too much is required, much is given, much is required. So that means I meditate longer for myself, my family, and my students, right? Just like I know my coach, Maggie, she prays for me. And she meditates, she prays for me. Just like you and Jen, when like my birthday, you guys sent me gifts for my birthday. That's a partnership. It's a mentorship. Yeah. It's so important. And as women, I do need to go here. We have been taught how to compete with each other and tear each other down, but we don't have that close kinship that we used to have. And that's what we need to have again, that close kinship. So when you have that, really explore that and honor it, you know, and then other opportunities will come. So the reason why is because I had faith in my coach.
Which gave you faith in us. You knew this is the right, that she would steer me in the right direction.
Exactly. And if it's not, and you know, sometimes things happen, right? If not, you learn from it, right?
Right.
Don't beat yourself up. You don't have to tear the other person down. You learn from it. What can we learn from this situation, both of us, right? The mentor and the teacher and the student.
Yeah.
And then grow from it, so.
That's true. So many times we live in that resentment of, oh, kicking myself. I shouldn't have hung out with those people. I shouldn't have believed those people, or I shouldn't have done that. And then you're spending so much time kicking yourself versus just move on. You learn not to do that again, and then how to do the next thing. It's so much more healthier for you, definitely.
We have to live in the now. We have to live in the now.
Yep. And then affirmations. Give us real some affirmation advice, the correct way we should be doing affirmations.
So first of all, starting with the I am. The I am statement is the most important. There's so many, we say affirmations all the time. When we say I am and whatever we put right after it, that's what you're affirming. So think about the I am statement. I'm great. I'm wonderful. Even if it doesn't feel like that yet, right?
Yeah.
But looking at yourself in the mirror and saying one thing positive about yourself. And for me, like this morning, I was like, I feel empowered, right? So what am I going to say? I'm power. I'm the power that I would like to emanate to other people. So it's about finding one quality about yourself and doing it in the mirror. So if you're just starting off, do it in the mirror and look at yourself and make an I am statement about yourself.
And you know, your coach, I want to give her a shout out, Maggie Cook. She's amazing, really super amazing woman. Maggie, hope you're tuning in. We love you. And I love the way she does her affirmations as well, because she sticks an adjective in there. Mm-hmm. I am so excited to be empowering. You know, I'm thrilled that I'm an empowering woman. And I'm like, yeah, I need some extra bonus behind that affirmation of, you know, making it sound more enticing. So, And I love what you said about doing it in the mirror. Sometimes we're just putting it out there. When you actually look at yourself and do it, it can even make you cry.
Yes, it can. It can. Mm-hmm. And also, if you have like a recording application on your phone, recording yourself doing it, saying it, and putting a pause so you can repeat after that. There's several things that are working. You're hearing yourself, then you're repeating it. I mean, it's just so powerful. And if you can write it too, that's powerful. You're using your senses. So the feeling is important. The I am statement is important. Saying it in the present tense is important. And it's, once again, I really want to emphasize, this is not a one set formula. It's not something that you're going to go through in a week. Take your time with it, because a lot of those meditations, as we were writing the book, we tested it. A couple of people were like, it took me a week to get through that information that came up during that meditation, because you're really starting to understand who you are.
Yeah.
In a more intimate level. So it's not like a breeze through while workbook that you just do in 1 week. Take your time with it, because you're really rediscovering yourself.
And you know what I love about that is sometimes when things happen too fast, you're like, oh, it's over already. Like now it's already through my system and now I don't have it. And this way it really stretches out and it gives you that support. It's like you're really enriched for a long period of time, not this quick little fix and then it's in and out of your nervous system. This is like you get to breathe it and really absorb it and cherish it. And so that's what Maija wants you to do.
And you just said a word, nervous system. So, you know, our brain is neuroplasticity, right? Yeah. So the longer you take with a particular situation, the more you like, if you look at the grooves in your brain, the more grooves that you make about that situation. So, right? So we're trying to make some positive grooves, right? Take your time. Let it marinate in those grooves. That's how I have to visualize when I'm doing this. Like, okay, I'm making a new path in my brain. Right? It might be a little bit difficult at time. Some things may come up, right? Some past trauma. And I do talk about that. Like if you have some past trauma, you may want to put this book down for a little bit and just work through that issue, right? Mm-hmm. Then you can figure out who you are supposed to be and move forward. But taking your time with it, it's not a race. It's not.
Any last words, Maija, you want to say before we play the video?
Yeah, I just want people to remember that, you know, it's about you. You don't have to do anything for anyone else but yourself. So wouldn't it be wonderful to understand who you really are and remember why you came here so you can make and have the life that you want?
Hey, are you looking to increase your revenue, build credibility, and elevate your brand? This podcast is brought to you by Elite Online Publishing, an innovative publishing and full spectrum marketing company. They will publish and market your book to make it a number one bestseller. Becoming an author is the best way to market your business. So contact them at EliteOnlinePublishing.com today. All of their authors become number one bestsellers.